Time for some more TYT science, and today we'll talk about the genetics of autism, because that's what's been going through the world press over the last week. Ever since, on April the 4th, 2012, the journal Nature published three papers showing new genes for autism. Now, these are not the first genes ever associated with autism, they certainly won't be the last, and they're not even large in effect size. Nevertheless, it's a very important set of papers because it represents potentially a turning point in our understanding of autism and the genetics of autism. So what I want to do is I want to give you the full background to all of this so you can see the colossal advances in understanding that we have made. I will do this video from now on in four parts. First part, our current understanding of autism. Second part, the history of our understanding of autism. Third part, the incredible advances in genetics and molecular genetics that we have made over the past few decades. And then the fourth part, I'll go straight into these three papers and their conclusions so you can see those in the broader context. Part one, what is autism? Right, these days we talk about autism spectrum disorder, or ASD. Classic autism, which is much more associated with mental retardation, the frequency of that in the population would be several cases per 1,000. But then there is also Asperger's syndrome, which we now believe to basically be a milder version of the same thing. But because we believe them to have the same origins, they're put in this bracket, same bracket called ASD. Now, what's the frequency of ASD in the population? Well, in 2006, it was 1 in 110, and just last month, that's March 2012, a new rate was published by the CDC of 1 in 88. So there is fresh debate going on as to whether this increase in rate is because our diagnosis is better or because there's an actual change in the underlying rate. Now, autism shows itself before age 3, and it is believed to be associated with brain development. There's plenty of theories going on with usually with regard to connectivity, overgrowth, developmental timing, that kind of stuff. Autism is also strongly genetic, but not exclusively genetic. So there could also be biological factors which promote or cause autism. Vaccinations are not one of those. Ever since the scares flared up, this has been looked into thoroughly, and there is absolutely no association between autism and vaccinations. And the original paper that made the claim was actually shown to be fraudulent. Now, autism itself is, or ASD, both of them, are much higher in boys and girls, about five times higher in boys and girls. The symptoms, what you see in terms of autistic children, is that they are socially withdrawn, they don't make so much eye contact, they are less emotionally involved, and they have a much higher preference for memorizing, systemizing, learning facts, this kind of stuff. And in fact, this cognitive preference means that about 10% of them have what we call savantism. And this comes from the French idiot savant, wise fool, basically because these kids show exceptional capabilities in these kind of analytic or memory-related traits. Now, if you've seen the 1988 film Rain Man, that's fictional, but it's a fair representation of savantism. Part two, a brief history of autism. Now, the word autistic was first used by Hans Asperger in Vienna to describe the self-focus of a group of children that he was examining. The word autism was then used 5 years later, 1943, in the States by a guy by the name of Leo Kanner. And once autistic children were described, obviously there was a lot of interest in explaining why autism came about. Now, at that time, in the 1950s and the 1960s, people believed that your physical appearance was genetic, was inherited from your parents, but your behavior was essentially a blank slate. So the personality that you developed disorders included, was essentially because of your treatment. So what child psychologists did was went into the homes of autistic children and examined the social dynamics, finding that the parents of autistic kids were colder with their children than most parents. They came up with this theory of the refrigerator mother. It didn't occur to them that maybe if you have a child who is utterly unresponsive to any emotional behavior, that after months and years, you just might be more practical in your treatment of them. But anyway, this refrigerator mother idea was peddled for a long time, causing lots of distress to parents, until later in the 60s, some academics started to resist this. Now, when we got into the 1970s, and there was more interest in genetics, autism was explored from a genetic angle, looking at family patterns. The first twin studies of autism happened in 1977, and then through the 80s. And these studies, though they were small, started to show that autism had a strongly genetic basis. And once you know something's got a strong genetic basis, then obviously the next stage is on to finding the genes. Part three. Okay, I'm back, it's later, and I'm glad I chose to do this in parts. Right, here's the genetics that you need to know. In 1953, the structure of DNA was discovered by Francis Crick and James Watson, and that spurred a whole lot of interest. Three key developments that came from that in terms of technology are, firstly, in 1977, Fred Sanger developed a method of sequencing DNA, i.e. reading it, and that was so important that he won the Nobel Prize for that just 3 years later, in 1980. In fact, that was his second Nobel Prize. He's one of only four people in history to have won the Nobel Prize twice. The others are Marie Curie, who won it for physics and for chemistry, Linus Pauling, who won it for chemistry and for peace, and John Bardeen, who won it for physics twice. John Bardeen invented the transistor, which is the fundamental component of whatever electronic device you're watching this on at the moment. Okay. Second key development was the PCR in 1983 by Carrie Mullis. And the PCR is basically a technology to amplify DNA, to photocopy it up so that you can better study it. So even with tiny amounts, you can use it. Next year, in 1984, Alec Jeffries, now Sir Alec Jeffries, developed DNA fingerprinting. So this is different from sequencing. This is finding various places in your DNA which are highly variable between people. So you take one place, you find out which variant you are, another place, which variant you are, another place, which variant you are, and with a set of these, you actually have a profile for which you are unique, and that is DNA fingerprinting. And you can see how the PCR and DNA fingerprinting come together to be such a powerful tool in modern forensic science. Okay, so let's put those aside a sec, and now let's talk about how genes impact on diseases. Now, ignoring epigenetics, there are three ways which genetic effects influence diseases. There's chromosomal abnormalities, like with Down syndrome. Okay. There's single gene disorders, where one gene going wrong gives you the disorder. And examples are cystic fibrosis and sickle cell disease. And thousands of these have been documented because they're fairly straightforward to trace. You just take a marker or a set of markers on DNA and you watch how the disease goes down through families, and you watch the markers too and match them up. So you quickly find out on which chromosome they are and then narrow it down on that chromosome to actually find the disease. Thousands of these have been documented. Now we're on to the third group, which is relevant to autism, schizophrenia, ADD, even disorders like anxiety and depression. Multi-gene disorders. Now, these disorders usually have a genetic component and an environmental component. And the genetic component, the genes can be additive, they can interact with each other, and they certainly interact with the environment, which makes them very, very difficult to get a handle on. Now, I went to the International Society of Psychiatric Genetics conferences from about 2000 to 2005, so I saw firsthand the frustrations and difficulties of researchers who were not finding genes in these polygenic disorders. Or they were finding genes, but then other people weren't replicating what they were finding. And so there was a need for cleaner designs and bigger sample sizes, and it was always bigger sample sizes to find these smaller genes. But one interesting technology that you should know about there is that when you're comparing someone who's affected with a control group, they might not have similar genetic backgrounds, and that can really mess up your studies. So there's a clever little technology that has been in use for over 10 years now, and that is using trios. So you take an affected individual and you take their DNA, and you take the DNA also of their parents, their mother and their father. Now, for any gene that we have, apart from X and Y chromosomes, we have two copies. One from your mother and one from your father. But that also means that there's a copy from your mother that you didn't get and a copy that you're from your father that you didn't get. So it's a really nice, tidy design of being able to compare the two copies that you've got associated with your disease and the two copies that you didn't get. Okay, so that's trios. Now, one final thing that you need to know about human genetics during all this time before we move on to the actual papers is the Human Genome Project. And this is a massive story, but I'll summarize it very quickly for you. In 1990, it was decided to have a world effort on sequencing the human genome, like with Sanger's method, just reading it all, or reading one person's, from start to finish. Billions of base pairs. It was planned that this would take 15 years. In fact, it finished in 2003, so it was 2 years early, and that was partly because there was a massive race on between the public effort and a private effort led by a guy called Craig Venter. And Craig Venter was also threatening, claiming, that he was going to go and patent all the genes that he was finding. And this caused great outrage amongst lots of scientists. And in March 2000, it took President Bill Clinton to step in and say, human genes cannot be patented. You cannot go and own them. And with this bold step, it guaranteed that, that human genetics is free for all of us to be studying. It absolutely crashed Venter's stock at the time, but the long-term benefits are absolutely clear. Now, the Human Genome Project found that essentially there are 20 to 25,000 genes, and they occupy about 1 to 2% of the space of all of our genomes. The rest is junk, fossil records, things like that. And also, they accelerated all these efforts around the globe, accelerated technologies, so that when, if you look at the situation today, just a few years back, Steve Jobs decided to have his own genome sequenced, and also the DNA of his tumor cells. That cost him $100,000. Now, at the moment, the cost of having your whole genome sequenced is about $1,000 in just a few years. So incredible technological advance on that front. And this has provided you now, looking at autism and looking at genetics, with the information you need to understand these papers which we're about to talk about. Part four, the three papers. Okay, now don't worry about this because we've got all the information behind us so we can make swift work of these papers. Now, first of all, they're about ASD, so autism spectrum disorders, rather than classic hardcore autism. Remember that I was telling you about the method of trios? That was employed. Remember I was telling you about the importance for large sample sizes? Well, combined, these three papers used some nearly 600 trios, so 600 individuals, and their mothers and their fathers, and in addition to that, another almost 1,000 people with ASD. And remember I was telling you about sequencing. Well, the technology has come so far that all these people are being sequenced, and this is the main thrust of the paper. And it's not just all of their genomes that are being sequenced, but the exomes. Now, remember I was telling you just before about that 1 to 2% of your genome which actually does something. It has live genes which are coding and putting out the proteins that are the building blocks of your body. Well, that's the exome, that part of the genome that's doing the coding, that approximately 1.5%. So these teams have been sequencing those exomes and comparing those in case-control designs. And that's the essence of what they're doing, to get the extra information and the extra power to see what's going on. Now, one of the most exciting aspects from these three papers is the discovery of the importance of de novo mutations. So mutations that in genes of interest associated with autism that are not in the mother, they're not in the father, they're just in the offspring. Now, if you would use the classic gene hunting technology of comparing common variants, you know, is it this common variant that's associated or this common variant that's associated, you wouldn't see that. It's only when you actually do the sequencing, the reading of each and every individual script for that gene, that you get to pick up on this kind of stuff. So, using this method, we've nominated three more genes now associated with autism. There are probably many more to come, but those will be coming as these people and their collaborators add in more individuals with ASD into the database and start sequencing them too, until we get to the stage where we have a set of genes and we know that any modification of those genes runs the risk of leading to autism, or at least making a probabilistic contribution to the development of autism. So you can see why this new technology, this colossal effort which has just been undertaken, which is only possible with the technology that we have today and with large sample sizes, is actually at the breaking point, in the tipping point, in terms of pulling in the flood of genes which then hopefully we can put together, look at their interactions and see why they're so important for brain development and how normal development versus autistic development happens in the brain. So, very exciting time, and it's always great to see information coming from the fuzzy edge of science. It's not a cutting edge, it's a fuzzy, cloudy edge in which findings start to crystallize and then eventually become the pretty pictures and diagrams in undergraduate textbooks, and hopefully also in this case, cures.